I'm sure you'd like to pass on your thanks to the CA staff who've been pivotal in helping to achieve that fantastic year. And can we also then pass on our thanks to your staff and the Wirral Council again? That's worked brilliantly. And of course, supported by one of Joe's team in Liverpool, because they've got the experience and allowed us to share some of that experience. So it's a real collaborative effort. And shows you that when you get a combined authority, you can get more than some of its individual parts. Okay, we'll go on to the agenda five, then is our first report, which seeks approval of the city region's music strategy and action plan. And the council mayor is going to take us through this report.
Thanks, Chair. Good morning, everyone. Just before we start, just like I'm going to ask, music board, just a strategy document, put a little bit more emphasis on Liverpool City within that document. Having said that, it follows on, doesn't it, from what we've just seen in the stunning year that we've had. That music is part of our culture, particularly to all of us here in the city region. The music strategy document, which is outlined four key priorities, to ensure the long-term development growth of the music industry within our region, to support the growth and development of sustainable music tourism across our region, to facilitate music and educated sectors to come together with a plan to increase engagement in music and investment in and development of talent from all of our communities across the region, and to ensure a sustainable and strong network of venues and to work with local authorities across the region to look at the to change the music strategy priorities for long term are supported with a 12-month delivery plan, which includes support for new and existing businesses, developing greater sector connectivity, supporting talent and artist development, and increasing music tourism and spending. As part of the promotion and the communication of the strategy, members of the music board will look to undertake a series of roadshows in each of the city's region borders from January 2020 to launch the strategy of the action plan to discuss the local music infrastructure offer and issues affecting music industry development and to promote the board membership opportunities with the current board places and launch the music board website. Chair, music is embedded in all of us, I think, in the industry right across the patch. And it hits on all aspects of our lives, doesn't it? And we don't realise what impact music can have. For instance, Chair, in my own life, on New Year's Eve in 1975, I was playing bass guitar in a band in St. Teresa's Club in Norwich Green. And at the end of the night, taking down the equipment, I gashed my finger open. And a young teenage lady came across, had a plastic handbag, and 44 years later, and 3 year old children, we're still together, so music had a massive impact, on my own.
Still regretting.
I'm sure she does. Massive impact on my own life, and I'm sure there's stories like that right across the patch. So I just commend the report and ask everyone to support it.
Thanks, Ian. I think it's not
a
surprise that you're a bass guitarist, it's that we can't remember 1975, so it's long before our time. Look, the chair of the music board is present. I'm sure you'll take cognizance of the comments around strengthening the bit about the Liverpool City region aspect of the report, and making certain that that's more clear in the narrative, as Shagan said. So, with that said, are there any questions for Ian or on this particular item? No. Can you agree the recommendation set out on page 13 then? Item 6, this report provides an update on the progress made since we declared a climate emergency in July 2019. Don't forget the first an authority of our size and a combined authority to do this. Councillor Polo is going to take us through that report.
Thanks, Chairman. As you say, in July, the meeting formally declared a climate emergency and committed to show a climate plan at the December meeting, at this meeting of the CA. The desire to produce a comprehensive and publicly engaged plan means that this commitment, unfortunately, will be delayed now until March 2020. There has been significant progress on climate response in the meantime. in our plan, and they include a major expansion of offshore capacity in Liverpool Bay and the opening of an offshore renewables innovation centre in Burnhead. Advanced plans to roll out the city region's first hydrogen bus fleet and emerging plans to further exploit local capacity in the sector being led by Halton. Work to mainstream the contribution of transport, housing and planet and climate response through other CA strategies and the ongoing spatial development strategy of the conference area. As you said, as you mentioned before, Mr. Miller, you attended the City Region's first ever environmental summit, where you announced the creation of a new City Region climate partnership to support this one. Potential partners will be approached before Christmas, with a view to the first meeting early next year. These will be drawn from the local communities, businesses, campaigners and academics, along with representatives from across the city region. The new partnership will support the development of the climate plan and oversee a new £500,000 fund to support community environment activity. So I'm happy to move the recommendations to.
Excellent. Any questions for Rob? Okay, if not, can we agree the recommendations are set out on page 39, please? Seven is, again, Councillor Hackett's going to provide us with an update. It's a quarterly report on the Strategic Investment Fund, SIF.
Thanks, Chair. This report provides a regular update on our Strategic Investment Fund. We are working hard, Chair, to make this money work hard for the people of our city region. The highlights are continued pressure on approved projects to deliver, which means we are making progress, but projects that cannot deliver, Chair, according to timetables, will need to make way for projects that can. Good progress in improving new high-impact projects. We have £18 million in skills capital projects at this meeting, £20 million in SIF round 2 projects, and £21 million in transforming cities projects. Chair, the city region pipeline is now so strong that we need to address how we fund it. Members will note that we are setting a high level of over-programming. More devolved funding is absolutely necessary, Chair. To finish, Chair, I believe you will suggest a way forward for the report's recommendations. Thank you, Chair.
Indeed. Given that we can take these on block, can we agree the recommendations set out on page 47, please? Is that unanimous? It's just because that last item we need to, well, is it D? No,
G.
G. G. Sorry, G needs to be unanimous. So is that unanimity across the board? Thank you. Eight is, again, it's SIF, but it's Transforming Cities Fund, and Pat, if you're going to take us through this report again.
Thank you, Chair. The paper itself presents three very ambitious projects for our city region, but are something to get excited about, as our brand new trains, of course, as you know, arrive, as you mentioned earlier, arrive in the city region, then to service from early next year. But the first project, Chair, requests £1.4 million for the first phase of our smart ticketing plans. This lets us move ahead of other UK cities and prepare for a London-style integrated transport system, which we've been asking about, as you know, for us as a city region for a while now. Very excited indeed. The second project requests £3.5 million to trial running trains with batteries. This is very unique stuff. If successful, battery power could help us extend Mersey Rail along the Wrexham to Bidston line and from Kirby to Skemmersdale. It could also save money on laying new track, and I will follow this trial with interest, typical Wirral resident. The third project, Chair, requests up to £16 million to lay digital fibre along the Mersey Rail network. Much more than providing fast Wi-Fi on the new trains, this fibre will improve safety, operations and efficiency. The team is considering how to include the spare fibres in our city region fibre plans. Chair, the new trains and these projects set a new standard for the whole country. Great physical connectivity, great digital connectivity, and innovation to improve the whole system further. And I recommend these projects on that basis, Chair. Thank you.
Excellent. That's the example of the new smart card that we'll be introducing. Liam?
Yeah, I follow that up because I think these, as Pat's rightfully said, really exciting projects. You know, particularly things like the trial of the battery technology on the brand new trains. This is some pretty new pioneering territory for the rail industry in this country, and there's a huge potential, as Pat suggested, to really spread the Merseyrail network to parks in the city region and beyond that it's never touched before. And equally with the sort of connectivity project, Pat went through all the kind of the important safety and operational reasons, but one sort of thing we should never lose sight of the fact that it will give free Wi-Fi to all passengers, something that passengers increasingly don't see as a nice to have, see as an essential, and as a key part of how we support our economy. And then the final bit, we're all looking forward to the sort of metro card and the smart ticketing report, but there's a huge potential of genuinely integrated transport and using other devolved powers that we'll be bringing forward shortly. Huge opportunity to build on that as well, so really exciting stuff.
Fantastic. And once again, we're ahead of the game. Are there any questions or comments? How can we therefore agree the recommendations set out on page 59, please? 9, again, Pat's going to go through this, but it's also for others, I think. It's in regards to the delivery of 2020 Good Business Festival. Pat?
Thank you, Chair. The Combined Authority approved the procurement of our Good Business Festival delivery team in September 2019, and this paper simply confirms the funding necessary at £3 million. The festival takes place next October, and we're all looking forward to locally, nationally and internationally relevance discussion on how purpose should drive profit in the business area. We're also working hard to get local businesses very informed and people to join the debate.
Any questions for Pat or any comments? Steve?
Thank you, Chair. I welcome it because I think it's taken it away. I mean, as well as touching on the international side, one of the key things for the Good Business Festival is for our SME market in our city regions to get involved and companies to be involved in the actual setting of the whole area as well. I welcome the report and look forward to being getting some of the SMEs and some of the local businesses involved in helping to get involved.
Any other questions? Then I think you'd be supportive, given that this links into our Fair Employment Charter and our the work that we do with the unions across the city region. So I think it's going to be a great showcase. If there are no other questions, can you agree the recommendations that are set out on page 105, please? 10 is this report provides an update on the growing business visits project and requests approval to increase our strategic investment fund, and Pat, you're going to start us off on that one.
Thank you, Chair. This is not a new project, it's a change to a previously approved project. Every pound, of course, Chair, we spend on attracting conferences to the city region brings several pounds in benefits by filling our city centre and town centres with new visitors. So we are hoping to provide up to £1 million more to attract bigger and better conferences, of course, to the city region. We will manage, Chair, this additional money through the LEP alongside our visitor economy department.
I'm sure Joe would agree with this. Of course, there are tangible economic benefits, but also the more people we get in the city regions coming to the city centre itself, the more we're changing attitudes of people, and those stereotypes are becoming less prevalent, because when people do come in, not only the warmth and friendliness of our people, fantastic cultural and visitor offer that we have, I think it blows people away, and that is hopefully going to ensure that we get repeat business, which is the multiplier effect that we saw on the lockdown. Any questions for Pat? No, can we agree the recommendations to set up on page 1? Sorry, Ian Mayor.
Just wanted to welcome this actually. It's a positive impact on our local businesses and a very positive impact on our regional economy. But we know, don't we, that people are many stunned, whatever word they want to use, and come to visit our region, like the city centre, the beaches in Sefton, food in Prescott, culture in Wirral, the whole series of amazing things to visit in our area. So I really wanted to just put my mark in for that.
Yeah, it is good news. Okay, any recommendations on page 191, please? 11 is our skills capital fund, and Joe, you're going to take us through this, but again, it's another good news story, isn't it?
It is indeed, Steve. It absolutely dovetails into the comments that you made before about SIP and investments, and your dad's about regeneration in terms of developed business opportunities. What we're seeing here with capital investments is giving opportunities to young people and the community colleges to actually invest in facilities to grow the skills that meet the new businesses coming to the city needs. So it actually dovetails, so it is good news. It's a 19 million capital investment programme, 18 million of that has been allocated today. And some of that is, you know, Southport College for their skills centre, Sefton, again, Cambridge, Rose Pulp, Riverside College site, also Liverpool City Community College will benefit from this. It's an opportunity for them to develop their infrastructure to actually not only grow the college, the opportunities that it gives to people within the city needs, particularly young people, but it also, as I said, develops the skills and the requirements of new skills that we need moving forward. So it really dovetails deeply into the package, and it's often overlooked when we talk about the investments in businesses and infrastructure. We forget about the colleges and skills infrastructure, but without that, we wouldn't be able to move forward. So it's a great news story, something that I think the city needs and should be proud of.
I think we'd all be absolutely in agreement with that, Joe. As you say, it overlays each other, so those skills with investment with our adult education budget. I was with the Merseyside Colleges Association earlier in the week, and they've actually said, I can say this, but they have recognised the benefit of devolution through AEB and through closer work and partnerships, and they also expressed a greater desire for more devolved powers to the combined authority from central government, because they believed that things like the skills budget, this item, they're better to bid into us because we know their needs, rather than to have to go through a central government process, which is very difficult for them to prove what their specific outcomes would be improved by. Because the national government has a very different set of measurements than we do locally. So they think things are going very swimmingly. And again, our AEB team, we have to thank them on our behalf. Are there any questions for Joe? Okay, Sefa, the recommendations on page 221 of AEB, please. 12 is a report, which is around the revenue and capital activity for the period ending September 30th, 2019. And John's going to take us through that.
Thank you, Matt. The report sets out the combined authority's revenue and capital position at the end of September 2019. The revenue and capital positions are as set out in the tables within the report. I'm very happy to answer any questions you've got on the detail of the report and generally.
Any questions for John? Okay, can we agree the recommendations are set out on page 243, please? 13 is just a bit of housekeeping. It's a notification has been received from Second Council that Councillor Liz Dowd is to replace Councillor Paul Murphy on the overview of the scrutiny committee. Ian, that's moved. Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that therefore agreed as on page 265 of the report, please? The 14 is, we've got no questions that have been submitted in the timescale, and 15 is no petitions have been submitted in the timescale necessary. 16, therefore, is the minutes of the Transport Committee, which is held on the 10th of October. Ian?
As read,
are they agreed? Okay, before we move to part two of the meeting, we need to exclude members of the public and switch off the webcast. as this is the last meeting of the year, can we pass on all our very best wishes, everyone, a Merry Christmas, and best wishes for 2020. The next meeting of the Cavado Authority will take place on Friday the 24th of January 2020 at 1 o'clock. And with that, it's recommended that due to the content of the next two reports, that they are considered as exempt in the absence of the press public, and are therefore asking for someone to move this resolution for the reasons set out in the agenda. Okay, then the Combined Authorities agree that the next items will be considered in the absence of the press public due to the information that they contain, and are therefore asked that anyone set in the public gallery now leave the meeting whilst these items are considered and can all formally cease, please.